Welcome, friends. This morning's presentation is on the meaning of Easter. Then at 12:15, we'll be continuing our roundtable readings and discussions as we do every first and third Sunday of the month. Next Sunday's 11 a.m. presentation will be on the three fundamentals. All presentations and other work of this lodge are based on the ancient message transmitted to the world from the masters of wisdom that HPV named Theosophy. Her steadfast colleague in this endeavor was William Q. Judge. Our aim is to keep these teachings alive and pass them on as we found them. Please help us with your weekly attendance or whatever you can do to help these uplifting teachings in their purity alive and thriving for this and future generations, as we all try to understand, sustain, and live this common sense philosophy. Continue to be guided by the ULT declaration printed on the back of our program, which is here in print and also on our website. In our meetings, studies, observations of nature's laws, in action and otherwise, we work to make the philosophy of Theosophy a living power in our lives with the aim of helping and teaching others. We work independently and with each other to achieve a truer realization of the self, a profounder conviction of universal brotherhood. We hold that the unassailable basis for union among Theosophists, wherever and however situated, is similarity of aim, purpose, and teaching. We have neither constitution, bylaws, nor officers. The sole bond between its associates is the furtherance of unity. We regard as Theosophists all who are engaged in the true service of humanity, without distinction of race, creed, sex, condition, organization, and we welcome to our association all those who are in accord with the declared purposes in our declaration, and who desire to fit themselves by study and otherwise to be better able to help and teach others. The true Theosophist belongs to no cult or sect, yet belongs to each and all. And now for today's talk, the meaning of Easter.
Happy Easter, friends. The time now known as Easter was once referred to as the time when Jesus was born. In the 4th century, Roman Emperor Constantine and Pope Julius I declared December 25 to be celebrated as the date of his birth. The Christmas season marked the time when the ancients celebrated the birth of the sun, as well as the birth of gods, such as Horus and Osiris. So both Christmas and Easter time are significant in history. At Easter time, the gift of life perpetuates everywhere in ways that remind us that nature is our friend, both spiritual and physical. The regeneration of life in the world around us foreshadows the opportunity for our eventual resurrection by the outburst of life from winterly thraldom, the vernal chanting of birds, the leafing of trees, and the chicks breaking through the shell to be born into a higher kingdom of life. Hares in ancient times and rabbits in today's celebrations have long been symbols of fertility, so it makes sense that they would be associated with springtime. As indicated in the secret doctrine, the sages of old used symbols to impress dull mortal thought with imagery suggesting new birth. The sages pointed to the chick pecking its way out of its shell, the butterfly emerging from the cocoon, and the hibernating bear awakening from its sleep. and the idea of the emergence of all life from the egg made the egg become the basic symbol of the Easter festival. As the young god breaks the shell of his human body to be released into the absolute freedom of spirit. The Theosophical Glossary tells us that the word Easter evidently comes from Ostara, the Scandinavian goddess of spring. The word Ostara means movement toward the rising sun. The goddess Ostara was the symbol of the resurrection of all nature and was worshipped in early spring. It was a custom with the pagan Norsemen at the time to exchange colored eggs called the eggs of Ostara. These have now become Easter eggs. As expressed in Asgard and the gods, quote, Christianity put another meaning on the old custom by connecting it with the feast of the resurrection of the Savior, who, like the hidden life in the egg, slept in the grave for 3 days before he awakened to new life. This was the more natural, since Christ was identified with that same spring sun which awakens in all his glory after the dreary and long death of winter. The Theosophical Glossary also tells us that Easter eggs are symbolical from an early time. There was a mundane egg in which Brahma gestated. With the Hindus, the Hiranyagarbha, and the mundane egg of the Egyptians, which proceeds from the mouth of the unmade and eternal deity. Neph, and which is the eternal deity Neph, and which was the emblem of generative power. Then there was the egg of Babylon, which hatched Ishtar, and was said to have fallen from heaven into the Euphrates. So colored eggs were used yearly during spring in almost every country. In Egypt, eggs were exchanged as sacred symbols in the springtime, which was, is, and ever will be the emblem of birth or rebirth, cosmic and human, celestial and terrestrial. They were hung up in Egyptian temples, for example. The Secret Doctrine, Volume 1, denotes 350 of its 475, this is Volume 1 entry, 350 of its 1,475 pages specifically to symbols to help us understand the science of the soul, the ancient and unchanging core of all. It says that no mythological story, no traditional event in the folklore of a people has ever been at any time pure fiction. Every narrative has an actual historical lining to it. The first manifestation of the cosmos in the form of an egg was the most widely diffused belief of antiquity. The egg was chosen as a symbol to represent the universe. It was a circle and a sphere, and the oviform shape of our globe must have been known from the beginning of symbology. Thus, the mundane egg is perhaps one of the most universally adopted symbols. The egg is found in every cosmogony of the world. The egg is self-contained, enclosed and within itself. It breaks out of its own shell. It is evolution in its purest form. HBB said, quote, appearing to the outward senses of all, the egg is a self-generated and self-created being. The shell can represent the sky, the white, the sea, and air, and the yolk, the earth. All three contain in one. And with the example of the pebble and stick, the fourth of the four elements, fire can be made to come out of an object, even though the object does not contain fire in it. It's still a mystery of science. The secret doctrine says that there are no ancient symbols without a deep and philosophical meaning attached to them. The lotus is a flower sacred to nature and her gods. It represents the abstract and the concrete universes. The lotus is the emblem of the productive powers of both spiritual and physical nature. It was held sacred by the remotest antiquity of the Aryans, the Hindus, the Egyptians, and the Buddhists after them. It was revered in China and Japan and adopted as a Christian emblem by the church, which made of it the water lily. So the church calls it the lily. But the seeds of the lotus contain, even before they germinate, perfectly formed leaves, the miniature shape of what one day will become perfect plants. They will. So in the lotus, nature gives us a specimen of the pre-formation of its production. Whether in the lotus or water lily shape, it signifies one and the same philosophical idea. That idea is the emanation of the objective from the subjective, divine ideation passing from the abstract into the concrete, a visible form. We can also take the lotus and further see how it can be used as a symbol to represent man. The roots growing in the mud represents man's lower nature. The stem moving through the water represents the inner psychic feeling nature. And the flower blooming in the sunlight represents man's higher spiritual nature. So the lotus or lily is a symbol of the threefold expression of the human being. On page 63 of The Voice of the Silence, HPB tells us that all is impermanent in man except the pure, bright essence of Alaya. Man is its crystal ray, a beam of light immaculate within, a form of clay material upon the lower surface. That beam is thy life guide and thy true self, the watcher and the silent thinker, the victim of thy lower self. Thy soul cannot be hurt but through thy erring body. Control and master both, and thou art safe. With the destruction of the Neoplatonic school in Alexandria in the 4th century, Gnostic teachings gave way to orthodoxy and the viewing of the ancients as ignorant pagans. The ancient wisdom found in Isis and Baal and the secret doctrine have begun to creep back into modern thinking, and many websites are accepting of ancient traditions of the solstice, the vernal equinox, and references to pagan symbols like the egg and the lotus or the water lily. These ancient symbols always belonged to humanity's expression of this time of celebration for the rebirth of life. They are not the sole property of any religious group, as some have been fooled into believing. The ancient Egyptians used the vertical line,
which is this one right
here, and it goes down into matter. It's the vertical line of the cross to represent spirit, and the horizontal line
to represent matter.
The initiate was tied to a cruciform for 3 days and 3 nights in the process of initiation. If they lived through that ordeal, they would step forward as an anointed one. The ancient Egyptians described the initiate being tied down as a Chrestos. A successful initiate was the Christos. So we can see that the cross and the crucifixion are also part of the ancient teachings. They are steps and initiation that every soul in the world must go through in the path of spiritual awakening. In Universal Theosophy, we find Robert's Crossman statement, in back of all the religions, he said, that ever have been, there is a record, the tradition of some great personage. Each of these great teachers taught the same doctrine. There is no difference between the teachings of Jesus and the teachings of Buddha, although those teachings are recorded in different languages. And an interval of 600 years separated these two great teachers. Every civilization that has been, and the one in which we are now living, is due to a true or false perception of what our real nature is. If we would ever know and understand our natures, we must first understand that there is in us that which never changes at all. Whatever changes are brought about by it, our inner self never changes. We never are the things we see, or feel, or hear, or know, or experience. It's also often said that if it's sight, if it's emotional or any of these physical senses, it's not spiritual. In our lack of faith, our unfaith in that, which puts us where we would not be, that's what puts us where we would not be. Denying the Christ within, the Krishna within, the spirit within, is the unpardonable sin. And so long as we crucify that Christ within, just so long will we suffer on the cross of human passions and desires. Service for ourselves is a creation which ties us fast to the wrong conditions. We may strive for better bodies, better positions, for the possessions of all kinds, better qualities, better understanding of one condition only, that the motive be to make ourselves the better able to help and teach others. The only true path is the trusting to the law of our own spiritual nature. So said Mr. Crosby. So, if we look over at the Christian gospel, let's see what it says about items relating to Easter. It says that Christ arose from the tomb. Theosophists say that the gods that we are will initially through natural impulse and then through our own self-devised and self-induced methods emerge and shine forth to the degree that we follow the path shown by our elder brothers. Stories found in the world of old and the appropriate interpretation of the Christian story typifies the potential of humanity for uplifting all of life. They show the experience awaiting all humans who reach their morning of deification. The body, though subject to decay, gives birth to the soul's innate potentialities. The Bible's first book of Ecclesiastes says that the body returns to dust, but the soul to God who gave it. Likewise, St. Paul, a Gnostic and early Christian, says in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 35, that, quote, some will say, how are the dead raised up? And with what body do they come? End quote. And then he answers, quote, it is sown a natural body, it is raised up a spiritual body. The soul is resurrected in a body of imperishable ethereal substance, which will not dissolve with that of flesh. Men's souls are sown in a natural body. The lower four, passions and desires, the life principle of jiva, astral body, and physical body. We often do the triangle and the square. The lower four, astral, jiva, and the physical body. This is the upper three, which is our spiritual selves, everlasting. Goes on and on. So we're raised up in a spiritual body, the developing three, which are Atma, Buddhi, and Manas. Atma, Buddhi, Manas. St. Paul tells us that evolution of our spiritual bodies is made possible by their ability to transmute into the likeness of their own glorious bodies. This perfected part is the only thing we keep from life to life, and it grows as we make efforts and come into the physical body and get that experience. The resurrection body is that body of the infant Christ in us, which we are now slowly gestating. Our every thought, word, and deed of brotherhood moves forward the gestation process. Our every mean and selfish motive causes this process to dim and flicker low. We have the choice. Our salvation is a process that is in our own hands. It is a living and continuous process to be persistently studied, lived, and mastered. In all archaic philosophy, the sun typified the divine spiritual nature in man. The moon typified man's earthly physical nature. The spiritual Christ in man, his immortal soul, is generated, birthed, and glorified in the constitution of immortal human through the conjunction of the two natures, the divine and the human. Easter comes in the spring of the year when nature herself stages her rebirth in the outer scene from the winter's dormancy. Easter is dated at the Sunday morning following the first full moon after the spring equinox, the conjunction of the sun or spirit and the moon typifying the birth of the divine child in man. So we often draw the circle up to talk about we have cycles and cycles within cycles. This is the cycle of the year. December 21, that means the sun is now coming back up. It's going south all the way. Are we going fully in the matter when we're talking about the physical? And then we start working our way back to the highest level, which is typically in June, when at December 21st, Christmas area, March 23rd, 21st, which is when everything blossoms out of nature. The full moon marks the completion of her divinization at the end of her pregnancy. The whole body shall be full of light, say Matthew 6, chapter, verses 22 and 23. The light of the body is the eye. Therefore, when an eye is single, that whole body also is full of light. But when an eye is evil, that body also is full of darkness. Take heed, therefore, that the light which is in thee be not darkness. If thy whole body therefore be full of light, having no part dark, then the whole shall be full of light. And when the bright shining of a candle doth give light, that's when it happens. Horus, in the ancient Egyptian dramas, exclaims that my whole body is filled with light. There is no part of me that is not a god. I am divine in every part. So by every suggestion of symbolism, the Christ in us suffers agony, endures his crucifixion, and makes his sacrifice of life for our salvation. St. Paul is right. If Christ be not risen, then our faith is in vain. If he be not risen in us, then we have no stake in the resurrection. Without the transformation of ignorance and pettiness in our own natures, we keep the Christ still bound in death, in the only tomb in which he ever lay dead, our mortal bodies. So if we for a moment permit the story of the resurrection of Christ to lure us into the belief that another man's alleged conquest of death in the long past in any degree relieves us from the evolutionary task of achieving our own resurrection, the story becomes a source of calamity to us. To the extent to which we look to a man or a miracle or any power outside of ourselves, to that extent we will let the sleeping divinity in us lie unawakened. 1 Corinthians chapter 25, verse 15, called the chapter of resurrection. It says, "For since by man came death, by man came also the resurrection of the dead." In the 7th chapter of the Epistle of Romans, St. Paul says that sin rose up and killed him. Death, referred to in these writings, carries the Greek philosophical connotation of the relative death, the unawakened latency of the soul when in incarnation it lay buried under the earthly animal nature of the body in which it had been planted. John the Baptist says that there are two men in our constitution. The first, our natural man, the first Adam, in other words, of the earth, earthly. The second, of spiritual man, the new Adam, the Christ. St. Paul in 4th Galatians said, "He that was born after the flesh persecuted him that was born after the spirit." When soul enters the body, says Paul, sin, which is powerless when soul was yet in heaven, springs to life and kills it. Says Jesus in the Gospels, "Unless a grain of wheat fall into the ground and die, it abideth alone. But if it die, it bringeth forth much fruit." Says St. Paul, "For as in the first Adam all die, even so in Christ, the last Adam, shall all be made alive." All spirit gives us life and goes through its death to uplift the physical creation below its level. So in conclusion, we'll quote from the Theosophy School Song Book, which says, "Life lasts in bud and bloom from out the bough. 'Tis Easter now, the sun his golden journey makes and circle wide across the sky. O radiance, teach us how to mirror in our eyes the gleam, to let shine forth the light we dream this Easter now. Thank you for joining us. We will now open the floor for comments, questions. Yes?
During the beginning, you were talking about initiation, and it said, you said, if the candidate, we know initiation is an ordeal, and you said, if the candidate survives, is it possible that physically he might not survive the ordeal, or is that another metaphorical death?
Well, we are constantly being tested. We're really in initiation all of our physical existence. This formality occurs, when we have advanced to a fairly high state, we're ready to join the perfected brotherhood. And the process we go through may or may not, in that round, result in continuation in this process of spirituality. And we could be in a situation where we need more experience, if you will, and we continue on and I guess try it again. The literature of this read did not get into that, but certainly points in that direction. It's a continuous cycle of trying on our part. And as long as we're serious about it, we'll make it. And the idea is that we are here to uplift all around us, and we cannot uplift ourselves without uplifting all around us. So the focus is on perfecting ourselves. So the, yes?
You read the passage from the Corinthians?
Mm-hmm.
And it said there that what was raised from the dead was the spiritual body. But I guess in the John, Luke, and Matthews, I don't know, where does it come, the belief that Jesus was dead, was raised from the dead, but in a physical form, that people could see him?
This student understands that the early Christians, like St. Paul, were Gnostics. And they communicated in physical terms because humanity generally understood them that way. This is easily misinterpreted, and this student understands that the Orthodox fathers, who ultimately won out in about the year 400, encouraged at least the folks who were following the Christian religion, made everything material, and things got added. The original Bible is not here. I think there's Gospel of Matthew. It's very difficult to find, but it does exist. But the physical Bible itself was written sometime thereafter, and the actual original is, there are many interpretations of the Bible. So that's, again, we can relate best to the material, especially in the West, and we have interpretations that are in that direction. Whether Jesus, I think by saying that he rose up in body and soul, that illustrates it. Because perfected beings operate here. Yeah, they take on a body when it's time for them to do work in the physical realm, but they are eternally in the upper three, because this is Atma Buddhi Manas. Manas is the evolving part of this triangle. And as we become perfected, more perfected, then the lower four, we don't, we just deal with when we are in the body. So if he arose in body and soul, to this student, it means that he was totally in that triangle, and he did have earthly things which also evolved back into matter, but the body and soul, meaning I think that triangle. Whereas we leave skandhas behind. We're always giving off skandhas because of our imperfections. That wasn't the case in Jesus and the perfected beings. They knew what they were here for. They could remember their past lives. They had a complete total memory, and they work within the laws of nature are totally in sync with what they're doing. So they don't produce karma. They're karma-less. And that's what this student understands. We can offer the floor for those that might have a addition to what just got said.
The view, just asking, in theosophy is the tradition, the idea that Jesus Christ passed away on Holy Friday and resurrected on Holy Sunday, is it viewed as such too, or is it different or more metaphorically viewed?
Again, if we try to focus just on the physical, we miss the point. This is metaphorical. Three days having some, all of these things, we call it Good Friday from the Christian perspective. 3 days and nights. Yeah, there's a lot of meaning behind these things, but it's not the physical being coming here, and going through that process. If we do it that way, I think we miss the point, And we're doing exactly what this writing says, is that we put the burden on somebody else, on a person out there, which is non-productive. That could be counterproductive. Yes.
But to answer his question, Jesus is not a historical character. There is no record of his coming during this 2000 year period. Mm-hmm. So that question that he just asked, whether the symbology is correct, his birth was not known, neither his death. The church just decided to
The church made it
set it on that particular day.
Well, we covered that. That's Julius 1. Okay, they made it. We don't know when Jesus was born. We don't know what century he was born in.
According to the Theosophical writings, he came 100 to 150 years before the historical era.
Yeah, Joshua and Pandera, as HPV mentions him as a likely Jesus of the Bible a couple hundred years before then.
The personality Jesus.
Historical records do not support the story of Jesus in the Bible. But we go through all these steps that's laid out in the Bible, the initiation and all that. Each human
soul
is subject to going through that. So it has deep meaning, the story does, but if we can't just say that was one man that went through that, otherwise you lose it.
So it's not Jesus' story, but it's our story?
It's our story, yeah, it's our story. So this is a philosophy. This philosophy is saying it's we have hope and responsibility. That's the philosophy of theosophy. We have full we we can have full faith that we're going to, you know, work through all this stuff, but we have to do it ourselves.
Is it possible we've been initiated in previous life, but we don't have any memory of it? Mm-hmm. Because we have a new body and brain, and until we get to the spiritual level and access, you know, the distant past,
full knowledge, yeah,
we're not aware of that.
Yeah, we're constantly being initiated, but this process is just brings it all together. What we do and what we think now culminates into this initiation that we talked about today. Everything we do, everything we think, points one way or the other, either up or down, initiation or distancing ourselves from the formal process.
But you just put the septenary principled man on board as a triangle and a quaternary. Well, the triangle is on the scene, mm-hmm. all through. So whether the personality remembers it or not, we have a witness on the scene. The
yeah.
personality is not important, but the individuality is. That individuality knows, is mm-hmm. the knower, is the experiencer.
Exactly.
Is the witness on the scene. Mm-hmm. So when the personality then puts itself in relation to that higher self, in the sense that that's the only reality, excuse me, and that is that we are, that's the only thing that we are, that entity, then that obstruction removes itself, and then remembrance of the previous life comes.
Right. It said that we, although science only sees one level of existence from a physical side, we only see the one level. We operate on seven levels of existence, and then the multipliers of seven after that. So we are seeing, when we're here in the physical body, we see our personalities and so forth. This is with us during that physical existence. But when we leave our body, we just continue on another plane, which we don't see right now, but eventually we will.
There are those who do.
There are those among us that we have the five senses developed now. That sixth sense is under development. We intuitively know we have all of these seven senses, but we only have five developed. Most of us do. The sixth sense is coming through now, and the idea that we are talking about is trying to. This psychic or the sixth sense, this is a student's understanding. As we develop that, if we don't keep the spiritual sense, the seventh that is coming too, in the picture, keep work on trying to develop that, which is for the benefit of all. The psychic is very personal and selfish. So as we are developing that nature, we need to also pay great attention to the spiritual side of it. Otherwise, we go down the wrong path. Yes?
Some people come with their psychic nature already developed.
Yeah.
But they don't accept this philosophy.
Yeah, that's true.
I think somewhere in the writings it states that psychics are not trusted with initiation because they have no control over their natures.
Yeah, you have to have discrimination along the way too. And yes, we have to have knowledge, so we have to have that psychic side. But it's got to stay in balance. And if we don't stay in balance, you know, the smarter we are, the harder we might fall. And we're all at different phases, stages of development. Yes?
But What about the scientific men of today? Well, he's totally intellectual. What about them?
They have to go through the same process. I mean, they might be very, very intellectual, very brilliant in their material thinking. But if they are out of balance, which they are, obviously out of balance in this world right now, they're going to have difficulty. They have to pick it up. They have to think in terms of the all and understand that there is more than the spiritual. It's got to be, everything's got to be based on something, and it goes, it's an endless cycle. It goes from one to the other. There's, you know, it comes from somewhere. So the scientific mind, the typical scientific mind, thinks in a concrete direction, but in recent years, the student is reading and hearing that some forward-thinking scientists, we discussed that a number of times, have contacted the Dalai Lama, he's being a major spiritual representative in this world, trying to see what they can do to design scientific experiments so that they can factor more in the metaphysical aspect, the meditation aspect. And I think there's a book out that's taking a look at where there's a dialogue between the Dalai Lama and these forward-thinking scientists that were communicating with him. So, I mean, what this says is we all have it in us. We are in different stages and so forth. And it's a matter of trying to study it, understand it, and until we live it, we don't really understand it. Yes?
The Western world, we're caution that faces a tremendous dilemma. Because those human beings who do not believe in total materialism do not also believe in the church dogma. But what is happening is that there's a skepticism that has crept into our societal norm, that people do not see what is permanent mm-hmm. in them or anywhere else, and they don't know which way to turn. So what we are warned about is that the theosophical students of today have their responsibility in spreading the fundamental proposition that karma and reincarnation needs to be accepted into the heart. That as long as the lie that we are here just for that one life is in it, the soul cannot open itself to its inner potential power. That lie has to be removed from the heart, because we are constantly saying that the Christ principle is in the heart. So if the heart is based on a lie, the soul cannot show the right way. It needs to be removed. Karma and reincarnation is the most important part of that philosophy, because it shows consciousness is on a continuum, that at the end of one short life, we just simply don't disappear, that the soul lives in a sheath that is very ethereal and will absorb everything learned in that life and come back fitted, perhaps for a higher expression of itself in the next incarnation. But until that lie is removed, we're assured that soul cannot open itself to its own possibilities, because that light in the heart cannot show us the right path.
HBB called karma and reincarnation the missing link. Mm-hmm. And there's a reason why theosophy was reintroduced in this country, because other parts of the world, because of the superstition or other reasons, like in Europe, there was a very backward way of thinking, materialistic way of thinking. This was a new country at the time, and we talk about sometimes that in our Independence Day talk. Yet the philosophy of it came here because it had potential for growth, this spiritual movement, and so forth. So the formula is here. This is the book, first book she did, Isis Unveiled, and the Secret Doctrine carries it on. We have to learn, study it, stay with it, live it, and understand, try to understand it. I mean, that's a lifetime of learning, if you will. And we're finding that, this is the formula. This is a lot of what science is coming up with. It's the embryo was right there in the Secret Doctrine. It said that Einstein kept this book beside his bed all his life, and he was very much into light. Einstein was, and there's a lot of light in there. A lot of discussion about light and the science of light of light. Well, yes.
This student came across a statement that says that HPB during her lifetime did not just expect her students to find these subtle nuances that lead us to the mysteries, and through the mysteries, secret doctrine, then we would be led to the Master's Lodge. But she expected another component from them, and that was that each student not only find the way for themselves, but also accept responsibility for the other, meaning that she expected her students not just to understand the secret doctrine, but through comparative study of the others, understand where other human beings are, and that they themselves then become a channel, not only just between theosophical thought and the thought that is in the general public, but a path of the inner life as well. And the article says that this loose ends has to be rebound, and this work needs to be completed by the students of today, that our mission is not complete, that we need to undertake this task.
You kind of hit on the second object of the theosophical movement, the first one being universal brotherhood. Okay, the second is study of ancient and modern religions, philosophies and sciences, and the demonstration of the importance of such study. That helps bring in those who may not have been exposed to this philosophy, and so that we can get an understanding of where they're coming from. Our biggest issue that this student sees by far is the historical problem of communication. One thing is to know the philosophy. It's almost another thing to realize how to communicate that to the world that may have never heard of this philosophy.
Well, if you're going to become a channel, then it becomes your duty to find out what works.
Absolutely.
And HPB tried many, many different things in her lifetime. Mm-hmm. If one thing didn't go where she expected it to go, she started something else.
Yeah. And
each human soul has the capacity to do the same.
Look at the resistance she got. Such a knowledgeable person who had many, many attributes came to this world, and she was fought in every step of the way, every angle. People didn't accept what she was saying and so forth. They criticized her like mad. So we have to be prepared to do that kind of stuff too. If we want to stand up for the teachings and try to help others,
we are sometimes martyrs, you know.
She said that theosophy very rarely requires someone to die for it. She says,
of course.
Most of the time it requires ethical living where you yourself become the role model. But it is the same situation today as it was back then, because the students who stand steadfast in that philosophy and hold it mm-hmm. are criticized today also.
Absolutely.
But we have to become really strong in our system of delivery. We can change the mode of delivery, but the message can never be changed. It loses yes. all of its value.
The great majority of those who even call themselves theosophers complain to be students of the philosophy don't get it.
Yeah.
They try to pick out the pieces that comply with what they want to do.
Mm-hmm.
The personal desire is there.
They have their own agenda.
Yeah, right. Those who try to stay with the core have a great deal of difficulty.
Yeah.
And there's only a few that really seriously try anymore, I think. This student's own view. Everybody is trying in their own way. But by the same token, we have to constantly examine our motives to see why we think the way we think, why we do the way we do, in order to try to get to the truth and stay with it as closely as we can.
Well, I think your two students have the similar natures, those who are faithful to the mm-hmm. messenger and the master's philosophy. They have similar natures that are true to the philosophy,
right.
And they are not here for position, power, or title. They're
right.
simply just there to disseminate what they have found. In
the great majority, form. I believe,
they
at least start
any...
out that way, but it's, you know, that's that old human nature, you know, the power and position and whatever creeps in all over the place, and it's a challenge. But I think that's, in this student's own opinion, these need to stay available to the public as they are, because that's our test, that's our check. This has been tested over and over again. Nothing substantial has been a problem with it. It keeps giving us the right information to live our lives, and it's ageless. People think, well, it doesn't have 19th, 21st century language in it anymore. It's some 17th and 18th century English in there, but we can understand what it means. And it's important, I think, to have that check and balance in our lives.
You know, I think there's a statement somewhere that HPV said, where angels are scared to go, theosophical students are not scared to go, because they have their own agenda and they go
there. I immediately thought about that song. So it's true. We have to be fearless.
Fearless, but not in the wrong way.
Right.
Because
using your discrimination, all that stuff is there, balance and discrimination and whatnot. But fearless. We do what needs to be done. One of the parameters comes to mind when we're talking about that, and it has to do with indifference to pleasure or to pain. We don't do something because it brings pleasure or because it brings pain. We do it because it's the right thing to do. And we have to keep that in with us at all times. Those set parameters are very powerful. Looks like our time is about up for today. Next week we will have the three fundamentals. And after a brief break, we will resume our continuing study of the key to theosophy. Thank you for joining us.